take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean me and Mr. Dave Boldt hanging out in Herndon, Virginia, texasgarage.com. That's TXGarage.com. And Mr. Greg Morrison hanging out in Hotlanta, although it's not hot down there today. Bumper to Bumper TV. Bumper to Bumper TV, Mr. Greg Morrison. Well, wash your hands, wear your mask, stay 6 feet apart. When was it? On the 3rd, a whole lot of people had to stay 6 feet apart. A whole lot of people spent a lot of time, hours and hours, going out to vote. I hope you went out and cast your vote. We're still waiting to see the final tally of millions. I mean, millions. I think it's what record-breaking voting from mail-in as well as on-site voting. But who we have here? Somebody's trying to join us. But anyway, like I said, wash your hands, wear your mask, stay 6 feet apart. We have Mr. Chris Lawrence joining us from Auto Academics, our PhD. He will later on give us a dissertation on how to tally votes in the state of Georgia. That'll be coming. He'll do that around 3:35.
After which I hope he washes his hands.
Yeah, right. We have several recalls we want to get to right quick before we venture off into some news topics of the day. 4,600 Polestar, the Volkswagen Polestar 2s, which is almost the whole production lot, has been recalled. They have inverter problems, so the car may lose power. And that's not good for an EV to lose power. Ford is recalling 375,000 of the 2013 through 2017 Explorers. There's a fracture of the rear suspension toe link, which means that that affects your steering and you could lose steering control. Obviously, you don't want to do that either, but that's two. And we have one more. Audi decided to join in. Audi is recalling 94,000 Q7s. The C-pillar padding may be insufficient to support you or protect you in a crash, a side crash. So as always, if you go to NHTSA.gov or the website of the manufacturer that has the recall, should be a place to enter your VIN number, see if your car is on the recall. If it is, call your local dealer, make an appointment, and get those recalls taken care of. It could possibly save your life or that the life of your family members or people that are happen to be driving around you. Okay, guys, what's happening in the news today other than a virtual SEMA show?
The big issue is I saw a story out of the Detroit Free Press that Ford is going ahead with the production of the Mach-E. And, you know, before they started that, they wanted to pull back all the test models they sent out. They had one guy who had a car who would not give it back and almost got into a fight. His name is Henry Ford. I'm sorry, Bill Ford.
Yeah, Bill Ford.
Yeah, he just didn't want to give it back. He had that much fun. They're making a lot of noise and beating a lot of drums about the Mach-E as a true electric vehicle, and it's being touted as a serious competitor to the Tesla brand. And we all know that Tesla's PR is basically non-existent, so there was no comment from Tesla in this article. I find it fascinating because this got a lot of attention. I got a lot of emails and text messages from people who follow me saying, well, is this going to be worth it? And I had to have a conversation with them about, make sure that if you do order an electric car or buy an electric vehicle, go ahead and spend the money for a charging unit at your home. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's interest out there. So the fact that Bill Ford doesn't want to give up his Mach-E and that they're starting to ramp up production. And you notice they're building them to order. They're not going to just say, we'll have 75 of them sitting on the lot ready for you to go anytime.
Okay. Well, according to Acura, the new MDX for next year will have a Type S, which is a high-performance model. It'll have a turbocharged 3-liter V6 delivering 355 horsepower. I don't remember the last time I was in an Acura. Have you guys been in an Acura lately?
Yeah, I was in the TLX not long ago.
Were you? Okay.
Yeah, and I'm in them periodically. I've got a TLX, I think, scheduled for December, January, something like that, and have cycled through the RDX and MDX. Has anyone else on this panel been confused when you talk about a Type S Roosevelt MDX? Anybody else confused about the notion of going, doing track days in a three-row crossover? Because that's kind of what they are geared toward, and I'm not understanding it. I would like to do track days, or I would like to take my entire family to the airport or a dinner, but I don't need to do both in the same vehicle at the same time. So, is anyone else?
No, I'm not. I guess I'm really not a big fan of track days, being on the track in a lot of these cars.
Right, right. And neither am I. Yeah. So
I don't, it's nice to know that they can perform like they're supposed to. Most of us aren't skilled enough to even take them to the point of where you can even experience what the car will actually do, other than saving your butt going through the turn too fast and you're trying to run off the track or spin out. But well, other than that.
Well, for me to be on the panel, you told me I needed to be a world-class driver. Was that not true?
Yeah, one of us has to be. And I said it had to be on a bicycle, and you keep posting that bike back there.
Fair enough. Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. It's well, again.
Go ahead, Chris.
Go ahead, Chris.
Well, I was going to say, like, when you mentioned the Type S, the first thing I thought of was when I had, I guess it was 2018 or so, the Acura, I don't even remember which car it was now. One of the cars was the A-Spec, and that was one issue with it was that it was just an appearance package, even though it looked really nice, you know, it was strictly just an appearance package. So as you were talking about this Type S MDX, I was like, man, you know, it's just kind of weird that it's the MDX that they bring in the Type S out first.
And not the TLX.
As opposed to the TLX or something like that.
ILX, you know, it's something like that. That
come on.
Yeah. And the MDX in standard form is a very competent performer. There's nothing you wouldn't need that isn't there already to do what a crossover, three-row crossovers typically do. So I don't know. But
unless you're going to drive it for the cannonball run.
Yeah, yeah. And it'd be a great vehicle for that. You could bring the attorneys with you.
Yeah, yeah. And the bondsman.
Well, let's try and work in a couple of what are we driving this week? What are you in, Dave? Anything special?
Well, Roosevelt, nice of you to ask, because I wanted to go on the Acura tangent because I wasn't driving squat.
moving right along.
but I would tell you, on Texas Garage, that's TX Garage, we have a book review in the absence of a press car, in which we discuss a couple of new coffee table books on Vespa and Corvette, both of which are published by Quarto Publishing. So if you're kind of in that, what am I going to buy them for Christmas or whatever significant holiday awaits you, stands to reason these to be good considerations. I also wrote an essay on why Ford should build a volume-oriented, volume-priced Ford GT to compete directly with the Corvette. The Corvette might be more than just a six-month phenomenon based on whom I'm seeing buying them. And Ford is building this GT at 500 grand. With all the engineering done, I would think you could find yourself a plant to build 5,000 of those a year. And you might not get down to the Corvette's price point of 60 to 80, but you might get down to a Porsche 911's price point of 100 to 120. And if Ford were to do that, sell 5,000 of them a year, give me one for the idea, I think that'd be golden.
Yeah.
So that's what I do in the absence of press cars, Roosevelt.
Well, if you convince them to make it all electric, they may pay attention to you.
Well, or potentially a plug-in hybrid type thing. And God knows they'll have electric drivetrains. I'd rather kick one out of the park for those that still want to burn gas a few times a year. And a Ford GT would be a darn good way of burning gas.
Great. How about you, Greg? What are you in?
This week, I am very, very lucky. I am driving the 2021 Sonata Hybrid. It brought it by the other day. I was just blown away how beautiful this vehicle is. The interior is gorgeous. 47 miles to the gallon combined. It's a full-size Sonata, so I mean, you got plenty of elbow room, leg room to work in, and that's $35,000 on the MSRP. And then I got lucky this week. I have a 2021 Toyota Venza sitting in front of the house. I don't know how I got this lucky, but I'm gonna say thank you. For those with short memories, this is a reincarnation of the Venza nameplate for Toyota. It is a two-row, it's all-wheel drive, hybrid, extremely quiet, extremely capable, and it's gonna hit that sweet slot between the RAV4 and the Highlander. Very well done. I have the XLE trim level. Unfortunately, I don't have a Monroney on it, so I can't give you a price point. But it was just a lot of fun to drive. I had gone to pick up a part for my computer, and when I pulled up at the store, Generally Intelligent Machines here in Atlanta, the owner doesn't let you come in. He comes out to you in a mask and gets, so you tell him what you want, and he goes in and gets it. He was just amazed to the point that he asked me, could he take a look inside? So I step out, he peeks inside, looks up under the hood, and explains that he had wanted a Venza back in 2009 when he instead bought a Honda CR-V. But this has just renewed his interest because he likes it even better with the new look, especially the new drivetrain. So Toyota might have gotten lucky this time with his nameplate and, you know, the right car, the right drivetrain at the right time.
Great. Chris?
Well, it's funny. You mentioned the Venza because my mother-in-law actually still drives a Venza.
I like the Venza. You know, I like the
2009 or something.
Yeah, I like the look of the old Venza. You know, it had great proportions. But anyway, go ahead, Chris.
So I am in a 2000, or actually I'm not in it right now. This is the review that I'll be posting this weekend, is the 2021 Kia K5. It's the LXS trim, which is the trim up from the base model, LXK5. And it's a nice car. Decent fuel economy, 27 miles to the gallon city, 37 highway, averages 31. It's got all the features that you expect now in a Kia or Hyundai type of vehicle, LED headlights and Android Auto and Apple CarPlay and, you know, just all the things that most people want in a vehicle now. That stuff comes in this second tier of Kia K5. Now, mind you, there was one little thing that kind of annoyed me a bit on this car that I'm not even going to say it right now. You'll have to check out the review, youtube.com/autoacademics, if you want to see it. But there was also one thing that greatly impressed me. It had a feature in it that I haven't even seen in $100,000+ cars, okay? And it's a feature that many people would want. So teaser there, little teaser there. This car ran the gamut of things that you might like or might not like quite as much, but overall decent offering. And you know, I truly would love to even get in one of the higher trim levels just to see how those are fleshed out as well. But MSRP on it was $25,455. And I think it was a legit price for what you were getting with that car.
Go ahead, Greg, I'm sorry.
Without revealing too much, it replaces the Optima. Mm-hmm. Is it a worthy replacement of the Optima?
It is.
That says a lot.
Yeah.
Have you seen the ad where the helmeted driver is taking the K5 from one wrap to the other, does the 180 degree turn and survives it? Have you seen that?
I have.
You know how? Do you know how many Kias that took to film that ad?
All of them.
Because it's an awesome ad. Yeah.
Yeah. This model that I'm talking about today can't do that. Disclaimer.
Well, we're very disappointed.
Not with the 1.6 liter turbo engine. It can't do it.
Hey, Chris, I want to tell you something. You can tell us because only the four of us are watching this video. But you don't have to worry.
Hey, that's three more views than I get then.
Yeah, right, sir. You don't have to worry.
Actually, five. One of my classmates from college is watching.
There we go. Teaser.
And that's and Chris is trying to let me know, I'm supposed to tell you to please visit the website of each one of the panelists. I always have a link in the description under the video panel on YouTube, so you can just click right over to each one of the panelists' websites. And please check them out. Give them some love. Give them a thumbs up. Let Chris know that you heard it first on his site, not here, about those special, those two unbelievable features that's in that K5.
And lest you forget, at Texas Garage, we have a book review.
Yeah. And they will be doing China next week.
Yeah.
China review.
It is a book about cars, though, Dave.
Yeah, right.
So.
Right. That's right.
Well, I'm driving this week. It's a Halloween color, the 2020 Toyota Camry TRD V6 sedan. That's a new opening that I'm starting to shoot for some of my videos now, just to do some teasing people of posting. Well, why don't you say something? It's a car review. And I have to remind them, it's not your traditional car review. It's a detailed walk around. But anyway, this is a 3.5 liter V6 engine, delivers 301 horsepower at 267 pound-feet of torque. And all of that is controlled by an 8-speed automatic transmission. The exterior color is a supersonic red, which I just love. Interior is black. It's really black with some red stitching. 22 miles per gallon city, 31 highway, 21 miles per gallon combined, has an MSRP of $32,920. Now, I do love the design of this new Camry. You know, when Camry changed the design, well, it was about 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago. But prior to that, I did not like Camry's looks at all. It was, to me, it was just a basic plain Jane automobile. But they really upped the game about a year or two ago. And then with the TRD, they stepped it up again. This supersonic red with the black accents from TRD, this really sets this car off. It's gotten a lot of thumbs up. It's gotten a lot of looks on the road. It has excellent braking. And like I said, the beautiful sporty design. Minimal body roll in the curves. This is one of the Camrys where I really put the pedal to the metal to drive it. Since it, when you get in these sporty cars, you just feel like you should be driving like a sports car driver. You just can't go out on the interstate and set the cruise control. You really have to put the pedal to the metal, like I said. A couple of things that I didn't like, when you take it up around 70 miles an hour and here in Columbia, South, in and around South Carolina, Columbia, on the interstate, there is a 70 mile an hour speed limit. So I normally set the cruise control around 74 just to be on the safe side. You get some internal cabin wind noise. And this particular model had no blind spot warning system, which I found interesting to be in a sports car. What do you guys think? But this little part here is a teaser. If you notice on your videos on YouTube, if you have videos on YouTube, most of the time people will click away in 2.5 minutes. They don't watch the whole video. So I started putting in a little, don't click away. You missed the rest of the, rest of the detail walk around. And I've seen my view time go up. you may want to try that, Chris and Greg. I don't know if you do any YouTube videos, Dave.
No, I don't. No.
Okay.
No. Well, you know, way too technical. Yeah.
You know, I think the problem with YouTube videos is people have the attention span of a gnat on speed.
Yeah.
The interior on this looks gorgeous, and the exterior treatment is, you know, obviously, you know, they've stepped up the game on that. And you know, people still think of the Camry as a pedestrian, you know, functional family vehicle. I mean, I don't know about your family, but my family would love this, especially my grandson, who likes anything red and fast.
Yeah.
So I have to make an appointment to get my hands on this. May have to strap him into the back seat rather than let him ride up front, because he's only 12, but he thinks he can drive already.
At 12, he should be driving.
Yeah, true.
I enjoyed this car when I had it. I was surprised, kind of like what you were alluding to, Roosevelt, where it I was expecting it to be a higher featured trim level being a TRD, but I was surprised to see that It wasn't. It was actually like a lower trim level Camry with this TRD package, this sporty appearance package. So yeah, you're right. It didn't have a lot of features on it, like the blind spot monitoring and backup sensors and, you know, like a lot of that stuff that you typically would find in some of the higher trims of the Camry. My other thing with the car was this was Camry's A-spec, since we were talking about that earlier,
right.
Where, you know, it had a ton of looks, a ton of show, but everything else underneath it was standard fare.
Yeah.
I compared it a lot to the Camry SE that I reviewed a couple years ago, where basically it drove like the Camry SE, in my opinion. Now, I caught a little bit of flack from that from a couple of owners of the car when I posted my review. You know, they were holding strong that, no, this is a much sportier car than the SE and all this kind of stuff. I disagree. Again, it had slight suspension tuning to it that was different from the standard Camry, which that's the SE. And that was about it, besides, you know, the extra bits and pieces on the outside of the car, including that larger wing on the back. Now, that all being said, I liked the car. Don't get me wrong. I liked the car. I really enjoyed driving. I thought that it was probably the best driving Camry, in my opinion, for, you know, for this generation. But it was just one of those things where I was like, man, you know, like, I feel like I could really sing this car's praises, though, as a TR trim model, you know, Toyota Racing Development trim model, if they'd even just give it a 10 horsepower bump or something, yeah. You know, like something a little extra underneath of the body to go along with that extra pretty aggressive styling. But I mean, you know, besides that, I thought it was a great driving car. And, you know, I just would have traded a little less spoiler in the back for maybe a little extra power or something like that under the hood, even if it's just extra on paper, you know?
I'm trying to remember a time, Chris, 55 years ago, Ford was tasking Carroll Shelby with making the Mustang something other than a secretary's car. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to think of the meeting where Shelby and the Ford execs would have been together, and they've checked off the horsepower, they've checked off the improved suspension, and they've even checked off some cosmetic tweaks to make it differentiated on a showroom from a regular Mustang. And then they get to the trunk, and somebody asks Shelby, well, can we put a Shelby-branded trunk mat back there? And what Shelby's reaction would have been. To my way of thinking, TRD is getting way too watered down. And while this is a very attractive car, and I can understand why Roosevelt would have enjoyed the week with it, to my way of thinking, leave Toyota Racing Development on cars that deserve Toyota Racing's attention. Yeah. And come up with something else for Camrys that you want to sportify.
Well, you got to remember, guys, the majority of Camrys that are sold these days are sold with four-cylinder engines.
Right.
So the fact that they're putting a V6 in there with 301 for Toyota, that's big news. But sure, I agree with Chris that, yeah, you make that 311, whoa, now we're talking a different ballgame.
Right.
I mean, it would still get a front-wheel drive car. It would get a ton of buzz from that, I think, you know, just because, again, the Camry's all along the full lineup. It's either the four cylinder or it's that 301 horsepower V6, you know, and that's the same engine they run in everything, including Lexus, you know,
and the Avalon
and the Avalon, everything. So if they had just done a little tweaking, whether it was like, you know, some intake, you know, exhaust, something that could bump that horsepower up just a teeny bit, just so that they could say it had a horsepower bump, you wouldn't feel it, you wouldn't really notice it. But if on paper that one said 311 or 315 or whatever it could have said, that could be a huge deal. I think that could have been a huge deal and was a missed opportunity.
That's like a pretty girl telling you she thinks you're cute. You know,
I think a lot of people who saw this car probably thought it had all of that, the extra horsepower, had the, you know.
Because it looks like it.
Yeah,
it looks like it's like NASCAR, you know?
Exactly. So when you get in it, you're probably going to think that regular horsepower is more horsepower because your mind has mentally shifted into, oh man, this is fast and sporty.
That placebo effect, you know, yeah, it's right. Like, oh, this must be better.
Exactly.
And that's why, in my opinion, it was like, man, but the SE, I don't know. It does the same and has more features. Now, granted, the SE was also like 8 to 10 grand more, which that was the other thing that I did like about the TRD was they managed to keep the price low again because it didn't have all the extra features in it that the upper trim level Camrys have. So instead of it being a $40,000 car, this was a $30,000 car, 32 or whatever. I can't remember the exact price of it, but it was much lower, where I was surprised at the price of the car until I went through the feature set and was like, oh, that's why.
Yeah, more show than go.
You could change the driving mode, shift it into sport. And it had a nice little exhaust note. I was surprised. You
it
know.
Did have an exhaust note also. They did tune the exhaust a little bit, and I was pleased with that.
Yeah.
So in other words, that trunk mat that's labeled TRD did not muffle that nice little exhaust note.
Oh, no.
It didn't muffle it. No, actually, it was actually a noticeable exhaust note.
Yeah, it was. It was.
My other question, Roosevelt, did you drive it on the tracks if you were at Darlington?
No. It's interesting. Every since I don't live in Charlotte anymore, I used to drive cars from Charlotte to Columbia every weekend when, you know, to visit my parents when they were alive, or visit my sister and Margaret, visit her family. We'd come down practically every weekend for about 16, 17 years. And then when we moved, I found that I don't really have any way to put miles on the cars that I get every week. So now with COVID and everything, every Saturday morning, we'd get up, get some maps and say, okay, let's drive an hour and a half this way and an hour and a half back. We don't want to get on interstate. We just take the back roads. And that's how I've been testing the cars. So this past weekend, we said, well, let's go to Darlington. We've been talking about going to Darlington. You know, the racetrack is closed down. You can't get in any place up there. The place is almost a ghost town around the racetrack. Yeah. So, hey, nice signage. Back right in, took a picture, went back home.
Dave, and also in response to your TRD comment earlier about, you know, how it's watered down, I can say, though, that on their trucks, I think that the TRD stuff has a lot more useful meaning to it, as opposed to what, you know, they might put on the Camry, you know, like they throw in a bunch of extra stuff, skid plates, and again, suspension tuning, bigger wheels and tires, all that kind of stuff that actually you're like, wow, this actually can be useful, you know? So this is a package that you get with a full Toyota warranty and you know, I think it could be worth the price of admission.
Oh, I couldn't disagree more. And again, that makes the argument, why are you watering down the brand to give it to Camry customers that would probably be happy with a TRS package? You know, they just want the gloss, obviously, and that's fine. But Audi, I think, produces an R line. Maybe that's Volkswagen, but there are other car companies that are producing kind of these half steps that are largely cosmetic, but they're careful to distinguish those half steps with different lettering or different acronyms. Right. So I'm with you completely, Chris.
Yeah.
Well, we have a new promotion at Nissan, Brian Brockman. I'm sure most of you probably known Brian if you've covered any of the Nissan events. He's been promoted to Vice President of Communications for Nissan USA and Canada. I want to congratulate Brian on that. This caught my attention here. This, you know, we talk about subscription programs. The car companies are changing them. They've looked at changing the pricing. They've looked at how often you can get in and out of them. But this one caught my attention because now they're talking about this company that's going to be offering subscription services. And I think they're going to be starting with BMW. For a monthly fee over the air, you can decide, since your car has heated seats, whether you want the seats to really work or not, whether you want to have different exhaust notes, whether you want your adaptive cruise to do different things. So the cars are going to be outfitted with this equipment, but you can activate, you can decide when you want these functions to be activated on your automobile through a monthly subscription fee.
I remember we talked about
that's
that.
Different.
We talked about that a few months ago. The problem I have with this, when I'm paying the price for a BMW, damn it, give me everything that comes with the car. Don't nickel and dime me about, well, you want heated seats, that's an option. Or if you want this, that's an option. I'm paying $60,000, $70,000 for a car. Give me everything. Or else I'm going to take my money, go to the next dealership where they will give me everything.
Well, it's interesting that BMW is looking at offering this.
And Greg, $60,000, $70,000, that's still their mid-range.
Yeah, right.
That's my point.
Yeah. You know, you're not even talking about like.
That's my point. You know, when you start spending that kind of money, you know, don't nickel and dime me saying, you know, do you want heated seats or do you want air conditioning? You know, come on, guys.
You know, we went through this for years with all these crazy packages. And then the car companies finally decided to start moving away from, you know, these 500 packages. Down to maybe 10.
Yeah.
And then Hyundai and Kia came along and probably reduced it to 2 or 3 or 4 at a max. Now they're saying, oh, let's take these packages and take equipment out of the packages and decide whether you can use them or not.
Yeah. But, you know, BMW's been doing that for a little while now, not in that way, but like where they charge extra for certain features that you're like, huh? You know, and I'm not even talking about like legit features. I'm talking about stuff that, again, Kias
should be free.
Entry level Kias,
yeah, right?
Some standard with this stuff, and then, you know, those companies want to charge $500 for that same feature. You know, and it's like, wow.
That's why I was surprised that BMW would be looking to do something like this.
And could I take a minute, Roosevelt, to remind Greg he's got 2 press cars this week. Why in God's name is he going out and buying a BMW?
Hey, if you're going to be greedy, go all the way.
I mean, I might go and buy one because I have nothing. You know,
as you go to your book talk.
Yeah, right.
Actually, that's my advice to those audience members who join us on video later. You know, think hard before you spend that kind of money.
Yeah.
Amen.
Get your money's worth.
Yeah.
There are a lot of options out there.
Yeah, when we
you have to pay for come with the car.
When we had the car buying service, we would always ask people, you know, what are they driving and why did they want to buy this car? What's changed in your life? You know, you have a new baby, you got married, you have a new job, you know, all kinds of things. And people want to jump way up and spend for an automobile. And they could easily save themselves thousands of dollars with something less that's going to do the same thing.
Yes. Yes.
You know,
can't drive your ego down the street, folks. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Other than that badging that they can point to.
Yeah.
Yeah. Rather than, and I don't want to belabor this, but rather than spend $35,000 on the Camry, walk into the Toyota parts department and get yourself a new carpet. I mean, that's $100 max.
Well, order it online.
Order online.
And on that note, we better go because Dave's gone.
Make sure you wash your hands, Roosevelt.
Yeah, right.
We're in an election season.
Wear your mask. Stay 6 feet apart. we're almost getting into also gargle. But anyway, if you're an African-American male over the age of 30, please go and visit your urologist and get your prostate exam. It's the PSA exam. I always say it's that little prick that could save your life, but please do that. Also, again, visit the website of each one of the panelists, show them some love, give them a thumbs up or subscribe.
Roosevelt, just 1 second, if you would.
Uh-oh.
I haven't read it yet, but it promises to be good reading, okay?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. 111 Porsche stories. Don't buy a Porsche. Just buy the book.
Buy the book. You can find us on blackpressusa.com. Also, please subscribe to autonetwork.com so that you can get notifications of the show itself. We stream live on about 7, 8, 9 different locations when we do the show live. And I'm finding that on other Facebook pages other than mine and my YouTube channel, they're getting more video views on the show that I get on my own my own website, you know, but that's okay, as long as people see the show. Anyway, as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. As Frank would say, buckle up, don't stream and drive. And we're going to have to say, buckle up and don't read and drive. Sit at home and do that. make Dave happy. Buy his book. Okay. Thanks, guys. I appreciate your time. Take care.
Thanks for
everyone, be safe. Have a weekend. Bye-bye.